In this Q&A video, we're going to answer the question, what does recommended mean in the regulations, and how does the answer relate to AFDDs in the second amendment of the 18th edition? Now, if you're interested in the subject of circuit protection and AFDDs, then please go and check out our free training module that we've made on this subject using some great products from BG Luceco. It's completely free, can be taken anytime, and counts towards your ongoing CPD requirement. You'll find links in the description or head over to the know-how page on eFIXX.co.uk. First of all, we need to bear in mind that BS7671 is not a novel nor a work of fiction. It's a technical document, and the wording in it is carefully chosen and selected for good reasons. Unfortunately, there's sometimes a bit of a disconnect between the authors of the regs and the readers trying to apply them. An example of this is in the understanding of the word recommended in the wiring regulations. What it means in day-to-day life is not quite the same as what it means in the big brown book. What do we mean? Well, imagine if a friend of yours recommends that you go to a certain restaurant. You can choose to either go or not to go. You don't have to do it. But a recommendation in the regs is slightly different again, and this has now been clarified in a section of BS7671 titled Guidance on the language used within BS7671, and the definition of recommendation is clarified in a couple of places there. There's a table there for us to consider, and it explains that the word requirement in BS7671 can be taken to mean shall, which I think we're all fairly happy means that you've got to do it. This is confirmed for us in the definition of requirement above the box, where it says, it's an expression in the content of a document conveying criteria to be fulfilled if compliance with the document is to be claimed and from which no deviation is permitted. So in plain language, if a regulation uses the word shall, required or requirement, then you have to do it that way to comply with BS7671. Some regulations may also include some exceptions to the requirement. Let's look at an example here in regulation 521.10.1. It relates to the installation of cables, and it reads, non-sheathed cables for fixed wiring shall be enclosed in conduit, ducting, or trunking. So there's a shall in there. Therefore, you must do this to comply with BS7671. There's further important wording in the following sentence. It starts, this requirement. So there's the confirmation that requirement and shall mean the same thing in the regs. And then it goes on to outline an exception. Does not apply to a protective conductor complying with section 543. So there's an example of a requirement. But what about a recommendation? Well, going back to the guidance at the front of the regs, we can see that in the table there, a recommendation means should. Now, that's a slightly different word to shall, isn't it? Think about that. If you should do something, what does that indicate? Well, we all know you should buy your loved one a gift on your anniversary. You don't have to do it. It's not a law. But what happens if you don't do it? Possibly bad things, even if they said beforehand you don't have to. Generally speaking, if you don't do something you should, at some point, someone will ask you why you didn't do it. But we can go a little deeper by looking at the definition of recommendation above the table. It states, a recommendation is an expression in the content of a document conveying that among several possibilities, one is recommended as particularly suitable without mentioning or excluding others. Okay, so let's break that down. If something is recommended, then a situation exists that you need to take action on to comply with the regulations. There may be several options available to you, and the authors of BS7671 have selected the best option. They're not saying you can't use another option, but they also don't give you a list of other options. So in other words, if you don't use the recommended option, you have to use another option. In other words, you have to do something about that situation to comply with the regulation. Doing nothing is not an option. And so to return to our anniversary gift metaphor, if you don't do something you should, it generally leads to bad things and at least a grilling on why you didn't do it. Let's have a look at an example, and we're going to go straight to the controversial one, the use of AFDDs in regulation 421.1.7. It starts by saying, arc fault detection devices conforming to BSEN 62606 shall be provided for single phase AC final circuits supplying socket outlets with a rated current not exceeding 32 amps in higher risk residential buildings, houses in multiple occupation, purpose-built student accommodation, and care homes. So notice there, we've got the word shall. So this is a requirement, meaning that if you want to comply with BS7671, you need to comply with this reg and install AFDDs for circuits feeding socket outlets up to and including 32 amps in rating. Then there's a note there identifying what a high-risk residential building is, and then we get to the part that's potentially confusing. For all of the premises, the use of AFDDs conforming to BSEN 62606 is recommended for single-phase AC final circuits supplying socket outlets not exceeding 32 amps. So that could read, you should protect socket circuits with AFDDs. But again, think about the actual definition of recommended. There are a number of possible ways to protect against arc faults. Using an AFDD is the one the authors of BS7671 have deemed as the most suitable. If you decide not to use it, then you still need to provide protection against arc faults by some means. You can't do nothing. And at some point, you may be asked what you did to comply with that regulation if you didn't use an AFDD and an arc fault occurs causing damage to an installation. One suitable alternative may be a documented risk assessment that suggests an AFDD isn't required in a particular scenario as the risk of an arc fault occurring and causing damage is very low. The key point to take away from the use of the word recommended in the regs is that it's not mandatory direction like a requirement. But you can't do nothing about the subject it covers. You have to do something to mitigate against the risk. Once again, for further information on circuit protection and AFDDs, please do go and check out our free training package on this subject by clicking the link below or heading to the know-how page on eFIXX.co.uk to keep your personal CPD up to date. So that's what recommended in the regs means. It's not quite as free and easy as that recommendation about a restaurant from a friend, but hopefully a slightly clearer picture of what it means for AFDDs and other regulations as well. But as always, we want to hear from you. Do you think this guide to the language used in the regs makes things clearer? Will you be installing AFDDs in properties or using an alternative method? What will that alternative method be? Please leave your thoughts or questions in the comments section below, and as always, thank you very much for watching.